the mind. That ocean where each kind does straight its own resemblance find. Yet it creates, transcending these, far other worlds and other seas. Blessed are these bugs, George, for they will inherit the earth. If we're not careful.
Lousy mixture, barbiturates and dexedrine. All dated this week. Which means they're not all on your own pharmacy card, Mr. Orr. Whose card did you use? Look, I have to have names. They call for me, I don't have a choice.
Well, he borrowed my card.
That's not true.
True? The truth is just a lie the computer hasn't caught on to. Use my number.
247-602-603.
I'd take it easy if I were you. Manny here hadn't found you?
How you doing?
Said I used your card, Manny.
I'm better that than they find out where you did get it from. Stealing from hospitals gets you put away, George.
What's it to you whether I get put away or not?
Well, I don't want to be prison visiting just to beat you at chess. Want me to put on the TV?
I know what's on. I dreamt it last night.
You gotta be careful now, George. Go to court, cop a plea. Don't tell them about all that dreaming stuff. Jellyfish time now. Float and drift. Float and drift. You know what I'm saying? Oh.
Tell me now, Mr. Orr, so I don't go in there asking for first offense treatment and find out that you've done time for half a dozen other things.
I haven't.
I hope not. You understand how the system works? Mr. Orr, first time you'll get benefit of the doubt, innocent till otherwise, that sort of thing. Second time, they'll process you without an attorney and give you the full TRANCAP routine. That's where they give you the lie detector, sodium pentothal, voice stress analyzer, and a brain scan, all in one neat little package.
Isn't that against some kind of a law?
Civil liberties? Haven't heard that one in a long time. I'm afraid that, that's from the good old days.
Were things better in the good old days?
It's just a figure of speech, Mr. Orr.
I know. I just wondered if you remembered when things were different.
Case number 937.
You ought to get some sleep. You look terrible. And try not to yawn in front of the judge. It makes a terrible impression.
You're presently unemployed, Mr. Orr?
Yes, Your Honor.
Is that the result of your addiction?
I guess they're connected.
You were a hospital orderly.
Yes, Your Honor.
We can't have drug addicts in positions like that, can we now? You gotta get yourself cleaned up if you want to go back to work. No priors?
No, Your Honor.
Owner of the farm card press charges?
No, Your Honor.
You do realize, Mr. Orr, that I could make you an obligatory?
Yes, Your Honor.
My client appreciates the gravity of this offense, Your Honor.
All right, Mr. Orr. You're remanded to a court-appointed therapist on a voluntary basis. Do not abuse this consideration.
No, I won't, Your Honor.
Good. Next.
Case number 937.
The black market at a time of national shortage is unfair, immoral, and criminal, giving as it does disproportionate advantage to the wealthy.
What a surprise.
Early this morning?
Yes. Feel like a game? You always beat me, Manny.
But you're improving, and improvement has its own rewards.
We eliminate disease, and now the population's out of control. So we have food rationing and a black market.
One thing leads to another. Have to keep that in mind.
It's my fault.
You take things too personal, George. But you have your therapist to talk about that. You ever notice how therapist spells the rapist?
No, I never did.
Do you think they'd do something about that?
In these times, it is essential to take care of basics. Make sure all your meals contain the proper nutrients and vitamins. If you are in any doubt as to what they are, contact your local nutrition center where free advice is available.
Illness is not a private matter. Your community has the right to know the health of its members, and you are always within your rights to insist on disclosure of their health problems. Have a nice day.
Sit down. Dr. Haber will be with you in a moment.
Illegal farm card usage. Uppers, downers, mood stabilizers, overdosage. Voluntary, no criminal record. Or the casualty of the pharmaceutical industry.
Lost is how I describe him.
Really? You bring out the maternal in you, did he? Okay, can we have the little lost boy in, please? Excuse me, I'm Dr. Haber. Have a seat, please. Well, George, it's all right to go right to first names. It's quite a habit you've gotten yourself into. I see you claim to suffer from bad dreams.
That's what I said in court. I wasn't encouraged to be more specific.
It's probably a good thing. I mean, this is the place for specifics. So you suffer from dreams and you took these various drugs to do what exactly?
To try not to dream.
Well, it's a very good thing that you weren't successful in your efforts because the end of dreaming is death, George. What occurs is a condition known as, if I can be technical here, central pontine myelinolysis. Chronic alcoholics suffer from it. Their blackouts preventing dream functions. Well,
I know it's bad for me, but I can't bear for things.
Are you so afraid to dream, George? What's so frightening about it?
They change things.
What way do they change things?
It makes me sound insane.
You let me be the judge of that. Why, don't you just tell me the first dream you had that you believe changed things?
It was about my Aunt Ethel.
When was this?
About 10 years ago.
What were the circumstances?
She came to live with me and my mom. She was my mother's younger sister. Her marriage had gone bad, so she came from L.A. to live with us. I think she was pretty unhappy. She drank a lot. And she would start to flirt with me. She was always in her robe, or half in it. I would ask her to stop, but she would just laugh and say, surely a young boy like you is not interested in an old woman like me. Stuff like that. I hated it.
Did you have sexual dreams about your aunt?
I guess so, yeah. But they didn't change anything. I dreamed that she went to Los Angeles to see her lawyer about her divorce, and that she was in a car crash and was killed. And she was.
Prophetic dreams aren't unheard of. I mean, did you actually dream about the accident?
No. My dream was about the policeman calling, talking to my mom about Aunt Ethel. She told me. My mom, I mean, in the dream.
Go ahead.
Well, when I woke up, I went downstairs, and Aunt Ethel wasn't there.
Did you ask where she was?
I had this feeling that things were all different. Like everything had been squeezed.
Squeezed?
I don't know how to explain it better than that. It's just this feeling. Back then I didn't know what it was, but now I recognize it right away. But I knew enough not to ask my mother. When my mother went to work, I searched the house. There was no sign of Aunt Ethel. Her clothes were gone. Her room was empty. Then I found a newspaper clipping about the accident. A head-on collision on Interstate 5 that had happened almost a year before. But I dreamt it only that night.
I'm sure this is not the only dream you had that you believe changed things. But do you remember them all this clearly?
I remember this one best because it was first, I guess. But I always know when I've had one because of the feeling.
The squeeze sensation. And nobody but you notices the changes.
That's the same as being mad, isn't it?
George, you're no more mad than I am. Maybe a little delusional.
I think about killing myself to stop it happening.
Well, why don't we just wait until I'll kill you first, okay? I've given you a prescription for some chloropharmacy. Now, it's pretty exotic stuff, okay? So, just a couple nights worth. Let you sleep without dreaming. And I don't want you to worry. We're gonna work this all out, okay? We're gonna sort it out. You just believe me. Why don't you make an appointment with Penny on the way out? Delusional psychosis stemming from adolescent sexual trauma. Phobic reaction to dream process causing amnesia and personality distortion. Patient's own term, squeezed.
Hot to trot, are we, Mr. Orr?
Beg your pardon?
Oh, it's an old saying from way when. Hot to trot means, you know, like, ready for action.
Yeah, I suppose I am.
Well, you can go right in.
George, how do you feel?
Is that a train cap?
Train cap? Well, where'd you get that idea?
My public defender told me about it.
Well, no. Well, no, that machine was used by the judicial system. It was supposed to reveal criminal brainwave patterns. Problem was that their patterns were the same as doctors, poets, policemen.
So what do you use it for?
It's a recording device. It stores and plays back brainwaves, nothing more, nothing less.
So what's going to happen?
Well, under my supervision and aided by the augmenter, you'll sleep and dream. Come on, don't worry. With this machine, I can see the onset of the dream state. I watch the brainwaves change, I monitor them, and when I see an abnormal pattern, I use your normal pattern to alter and control the situation.
But you won't know what I'm dreaming.
Yes, I will. When I've hypnotized you, I'll give you a dream instruction, something very soothing, very pleasant. And, come on, just relax. That's it. Now, isn't going to change anything except maybe your fear of dreaming just a little. Are you ready? Good. And, you want to sit up for me? And this is to honor your heart. Fashion, but that new either. I want you to concentrate on the hole, George. Just the hole. Watch the hole and the ring will disappear. Relax your breathing. Watch the hole. One in. And two out. And three in. Can you hear me? Okay, we're going to have a nice dream. Something very vivid. Not too exciting. I want you to think of a horse, George. A big, beautiful white horse. And it's running up and down. Running up and down. You're not on the horse. You're watching, perfectly safe. Far away from the flying hooves. Now when I say New York, you're going to go into your dream. And you're going to stay there as long as you like. And New York
having a good old snooze,
Sissy. Dream deprivation, Penny. It's almost as bad as sex deprivation.
Oh, now look what you made me do.
Could that have possibly been the mention of the word sex, Penny?
You know, I could report you for remarks like that, Dr. Haber.
Of course you could, Penny. But we both know you won't any more than you take my advice about the clothes that you wear.
What's wrong with my clothes?
Oh, basically, they're not clothes. They're camouflage.
I suppose you'd have me dressed like Lady Godiva. Don't you know who Lady Godiva is?
Oh, please enlighten me, Penny.
Well, she was this lady in olden times. She rode naked on a horse.
Naked? Sounds a bit like wishful thinking. Excuse me. Had 45 minutes of continuous dream sleep. It's pretty remarkable. How do you feel, George?
I feel squeezed.
Squeezed? I can assure you, you don't look squeezed, George. You do have, to say the least, some very interesting brain patterns, and I think it would be a good idea if we met 3 times a week so that I could build a profile on you, because I believe that the information would be very valuable. I really do.
before I went to sleep, the picture on your wall was of a mountain. You don't remember that?
Well, I think you dreamt that, George.
No. You told me to dream of a horse, a white horse.
Well, why don't I ask Penny? I'm sure she'll remember.
No, you don't understand. It'll seem just the same to her. My dreams change things for everyone.
Penny! Penny! Did you come in here for a minute?
Yes, doctor.
George here was commenting on our mural. He thought it was rather suggestive.
It's Lady Godiva. Hot to trot.
Thank you.
I told you.
Yes, you did.
You didn't notice your secretary's clothes were different.
And so, as a result of your dreaming, is that what you're suggesting? But George, why? Why would you change Penny's clothing?
I don't know, but yes.
Certainly in keeping with the Lady Godiva motif, she should be naked. Very productive relationship.
So, how's it going with the rapist?
I think he's pretty smart. But he doesn't believe me. Nobody believes me.
But you believe you. That's the main thing.
Why is that the main thing? That might just mean I'm crazy.
Oh, believing what you know to be true and nobody else does, it doesn't make you crazy. Loony, maybe. Trust me, George. I've been doing this as long as I can remember. See, I told you were improving.
Seat yourself comfortably. Preferably in a darkened room with relative quiet. Concentrate on the pattern. Trying to interpret the shapes. Let the images flow through your mind. Breathe naturally. After the first set is over, get up, walk around, and then return in time to be ready for the next set.
Okay, now, been dreaming like this since you're 16?
That I remember, yes.
Right. But, I mean, it's only recently that you resorted to drugs to try to stop them. Why? I mean, why do you suppose that is? What prompted that?
I'm not sure. I think...
You think?
I think I lost someone. I dreamed him away.
Who is it you think you lost?
I don't know.
Why couldn't you just lie down and dream her back in your life?
Why do you say her?
Well, pretty safe bet, I think. You being a he.
It doesn't work like that. Even if I knew who she was, I can't just dream her back into my life. Dreams don't go in a straight line. You know that.
It's true. You're a bit mysterious. So, why don't we see what's in store for us today? All right? Okay, George.
George, relax your breathing. Concentrate. One in. And five. Then close your eyes, George. And what should we have you dream today that will cause nobody any harm? You're a brilliant, distinguished-looking therapist. Deserves an office with a beautiful outside view. Fabulous, George. Well, you certainly spun our dials today.
You look different.
Different.
Do you like your office?
My office, yes, indeed. I mean, with fame comes ever widening prospects.
Are you famous then?
I'm well renowned in my profession, in no small measure as a result of our collaboration.
Here are your notes for the lecture this evening, Doctor.
Thank you, Patty. Will you be attending?
Oh, I wouldn't miss it for anything. How are you today, Mr. Rohr? Isn't it nice to see the mountains on a clear day like this?
The lathe of heaven.
Let's catch a little title, eh? It's taken from ancient Chinese text on dreams. No particular modern relevance. They're inclined to believe that their dreams were fortune-telling devices. My lecture is more to do with our machine. They gave up on the uses of that machine far too early, and basically, it was I who insisted that that much more important use in therapy as a lathe, if you like, tuning our uneven dreams into perfectly finished artifacts. I sure hope you come tonight, George, because I think you recognize much of what I have to say. So, you will come. So, with the augmenta, we have the prospect of actually making dreams a means improving our lives. They would not just simply be enigmatic narratives that we'd have to try to decipher and understand in the morning. We can dream sane dreams. We can live sane lives. This is the future. And with the augmenta, the future is now. So I would like to thank you all for your attention. And after a short break, which I'm sure you'll all enjoy, I'll be happy to answer any of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Mr. Orr, have a seat. What can I do for you this time? Not in violation of your voluntary status, I hope.
No. I want to see if I can get another therapist.
On what grounds?
Invasion of privacy.
Isn't that rather like a woman accusing her gynecologist of touching her genitalia?
Do you know what an augmenter is?
No.
It's a biofeedback machine. Dr. Haber uses one in our sessions.
Uses it for what?
He records my brainwaves while I'm dreaming.
Why?
He thinks he can control my dreams through it.
And can he?
He can make suggestions, but things don't come out the way one expects with dreams.
He's quite the man, your Dr. Haber. Harvard, Columbia, presidential appointee.
Those are things that he made me dream.
Well, this, what did you call it, augmenter? It's not even licensed for therapeutic sessions.
Well, I'm not trying to get Dr. Haber into trouble.
Oh, you can't get him into trouble. Only he can do that. I would advise you to forget this invasion of privacy complaint. I think civil liberties is the way to approach your concern.
I thought that was something from the good old days.
Yes. It's still in the books. And I think it might actually apply here. I'm sorry. Dr. Haber hasn't been able to help you, Mr. Orr. George, isn't it?
Yes. Yours is Heather.
Yes, it is. How do you know my name? I don't remember giving it to you.
No, I must have seen it somewhere.
I will attempt to sit in on one of your sessions with Dr. Haber, and we'll see if you have a civil liberties issue.
You can do that?
Yeah. This department has oversight in cases like yours, and, well, the use of this machine isn't even authorized, so...
Can I tell you what to watch for?
No. No, you may not. I'd be doing this not as your advocate, but as an objective observer. Is that clear? Good. That's your time slot filled, Mr. Orr. Good day.
Is that your husband?
Yeah. He's in Europe with the peacekeeping forces.
It's a difficult job.
Yes, it is.
Comfortable, George? Enjoyed the lecture?
I thought it was very persuasive. And quite mistaken.
Oh? No. What particular respect?
I don't think you know what dreams are.
Well, let's see. The bushmen of the Kalahari Desert believed a dream was dreaming us. How's that work for you?
It's better than thinking that you can manufacture dreams to fit some useful function.
George, we shouldn't be adversaries. We're partners.
I don't think so. I think you're using me.
Using you what? What for?
Personal advancement. That's not the worst thing. You won't even admit that you believe me.
Part of what we do in our profession is to enter the patient's world, not necessarily to believe, but to identify with.
And you can identify with me to the the point that you're now a famous psychiatrist with a view of a mountain instead of just a photograph.
George, you'll damage my chair.
I don't want to do this anymore. I'm a voluntary patient.
And by definition, voluntary patients cooperate.
There's a definition of voluntary.
It's better than obligatory, I can promise you that. George, this isn't going to hurt a thing. Come on, George. Relax. That's it. Just relax.
Now in its second year, the disease Lendrix virus shows no signs of lessening its ravages on the predominantly Caucasian population. As yet, stringent quarantine measures have contained the disease to Europe, where serious depopulation has caused a breakdown in government.
How's it going, George?
A panel of American scientists will meet with the president in the nation's capital to discuss the
fact. You don't want to watch that stuff. Come on, let's have a game. Anything that goes to the trouble of happening was inevitable anyhow. You will, George. You will.
How? He can have me made obligatory anytime he likes. I'm helpless.
Oh, he has to show cause and get a court order. Then you can object through your counselor. What's her name?
LaLash. Heather LaLash.
So, you're not helpless.
You know what I think?
What do you think, George?
I think I know her. From before. From the past.
Oh, amen to that.
But I don't think she remembers. She's married now.
Well, that happens sometimes. But you know what? There's always the next time. Make your move, George. That's the only way the game gets played.
I need to remind you to conduct yourself as if we've never met.
Ms. LaLash, I think that... I believe that we've met before. Before the court. Before you were married.
Look. I got an excellent memory for faces. I don't think so.
You never had even a feeling.
Why do you think that we've known each other before? I mean, you don't even remember where or when.
Because every time I have one of these dreams, everything gets changed around. And reconstructed everything. It's like we've jumped tracks and we're heading in a new direction.
Let me ask you something. When, you're up awake late at night trying not to dream, do you watch a lot of television? You know, like old shows about dual time tracks, alternate universes.
How did I know your name was Heather?
I don't know how you knew my name was Heather. Look, I can't help you with these beliefs that you have.
After the session, can we meet?
I'll meet you back here.
No, at the Riverside Bistro.
At the Riverside Bistro? You go there?
No, I've never been there that I can remember.
Then why the bistro?
It's like your name. I have no idea.
Me too. At the bistro.
Where is it?
It's on the promenade. It's rather expensive, Mr. Orr.
Maybe I'll dream I'm rich. How's your husband in Europe?
He's fine. Thank you. He has immunity to the Lendrix virus being Asian.
Oh, good. I don't know why I dreamed that part.
Very big office you have.
The better to impress you with.
I'm impressed.
Good. Please. So you've come to keep us honest, have you?
Random check procedure.
I see. Please. You've random onto a very interesting case.
Uh-huh.
Any training in psychiatric or psychoanalytic theory?
No, I can't say that I have.
Well, may I ask how you expect to make a coherent assessment of what you're about to witness today?
He'll explain to me what's happening in lay terms, and I'll observe, and report.
And if I don't brain fry him, you'll consider that a passing mark?
Is there any likelihood of that happening?
No. None whatsoever. This is a monitoring function, not an initiatory one.
Mr. Orr just arrived.
Well, thank you, Penny. Send him in. George. Well, how are you today? Oh. Excuse me. This is Miss
Lalash.
Lalash, excuse me. Miss Lalash, she's from the Department of Public Services. Just a routine visit, nothing whatsoever to do with you. It's just part of that body's function. And George, if you don't mind, since we have a lovely visitor today, would you mind terribly if we started immediately? Good, you sure?
Yeah.
Completely out of your mind. In fact, I'll instruct you to do that in the session.
I don't need you to instruct me on that.
Very well, George, as you like. Okay. Where shall we direct you today? Are you still finding the overcrowding in the subways oppressive?
No more for me than anyone else.
Well,
would just aim at some elbow room. Wide open country, wilderness, pastoral peace, quiet, a beautiful place in the country. So when I count to five, you'll be asleep. Beautiful place in the country, George. It's peaceful and quiet, beautiful. And one in. And two. And three in, George. And four. Observe the computer, you can see the brain waves that George is now creating. This is a previous dream state. Now we know that that dream caused George no anxiety. We run them parallel, using this one as the control, and we can modify any unusual patterns.
So when you say that it does not initiate, that's not strictly speaking accurate.
This is not initiatory. Complimentary would be a more exact term. Now, Miss Lalash, I must ask you to be quiet and observe. Any input, no matter how trivial, might influence the session. So please.
Something happening?
I ask you to make no comment of any kind.
Now, what you've just witnessed is what we call a dream drama. If it had happened in an unmonitored situation, he would have woken, convinced that he had made certain changes in the outer world. I mean, his belief is so intense it causes amnesia, blocking out parts of his life, and it allows his memory to conform to his dreams. It's extremely painful. It's unique and very valuable to science.
Is Mr. Orr being experimented upon?
Experimented on? No, absolutely not, and I'd really resent any inference to that in your report.
Yes, but during his dream drama, you did try to control his dreaming, did you not?
No external elements were introduced.
Seems to me you yourself are an external element, Professor.
I am Mr. Orr's court-appointed therapist.
Yes, I'm rather surprised, actually, that someone as eminent as yourself is still taking court-appointed patients.
And I am equally surprised that a law firm as prestigious as yours would undertake such a small oversight function.
Beard Hall and Stallings do a considerable amount of pro bono work.
Miss Lash, I would like to assure you that George Orr's welfare is my preeminent concern. Over the years that he's been my patient, I've grown very, very fond of him. And the poor man suffers terribly from guilt over things he's not responsible for.
Such as?
The epidemic in Europe.
The Lendrix virus?
Yes, he believes he did that to control over population.
And what about its appearance here in the U.S.?
Yeah, that too, I'm afraid so, yes.
Well, does the man have a family?
Oh, he believes his family's dead.
He believes. He doesn't know? I have to go. I have another appointment.
Oh, excuse me. Just thought, perhaps sometime that you and I could have some lunch. I mean, if you're not already spoken for.
I'm afraid I can't. It'd be a breach of professional protocol. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, Penny. What is it?
The lady raises your blood pressure, Professor. Should I be jealous?
Heather. Where is everyone?
Panic, George. It's not rush hour yet. Who's Heather? Girlfriend, you've never mentioned her. Until tomorrow, then. Penny, call the Lashes Farm and get me her full name.
Hot to trot, are we?
Another report indicating that the arrival of the Lendrix virus in the United States 3 years ago was unpreventable was published today in the Times. Scientist...
I've got your new Lady Godiva's first name.
Heather.
Well, if you already knew, why did you tell me...
Deputy security right away. Security. Yes, this is Professor Haber. I'd like to change the status on one of my patients, or George, or he's presently voluntary. I want him made obligatory.
You'll need a court order.
Yes, I understand about the court order. One will be obtained, but I want the change effective immediately. I want him contacted and detained.
Sounds like an emergency.
That's exactly what it is, an emergency.
Mr. Orr.
It's Manfred, isn't it?
That's right, sir.
How long have I lived here?
At the Towers? About two and a half years.
Since the plague?
I haven't heard it called that in a long time.
Good afternoon, Mr.
Orr. Good afternoon.
Good night, Captain.
Hello?
Mr. Orr?
Yes.
Mr. Orr, this is Ms. LaLache's secretary. Ms. LaLache asked me to phone you regarding your lunch engagement.
My lunch with Ms. LaLache?
Ms. LaLache has been waiting almost 30 minutes.
Please tell her to wait. I'm on my way. Where were we going to meet again?
The Riverside Bistro.
Yes, yes, of course. Thank you.
Hello, Mr. Orr. Two gentlemen are waiting for you out front. I think they may be from the Department of Mental Health.
Dr. Haber must have made me an obligatory.
Maybe you should go away for a while, George, to your place in the country.
Sorry. I'm really sorry.
You know, this was your idea. We could have met at my office with a lot less inconvenience.
No, this is better.
So you want to know what I think of your Professor Haber?
Hi there. May I tell you the specials?
Huh?
The specials.
Oh, I'll have it.
There's more than one special, sir.
I'll have the first one.
I'll have the usual time.
Very good, Mr. Lash. And you, sir, you don't want to know what the specials are?
No, I'm sure they're special.
Fine. It won't be long.
You really do work at being eccentric, don't you?
Miss Alash, how long have you known me for?
How long? You came to our office 3 weeks ago.
You don't remember representing me on a farm card violation? When you're a public defender?
I think you're mistaken.
Do you remember working as a public defender?
Of course I remember working as a public defender. That was 3 years ago.
You're in room 3007. Little box of a place. Are you still married?
My husband died during the hostilities. How do you know these things about me, Mr. Orr? You've been checking up on me.
No. I came to your office when you were a public defender. Your husband, he was Asian.
How do you know my husband was Asian?
I saw his photograph on your shelf. Listen, I know this is hard to understand, but it's true. Do you remember what Dr. Haber instructed me to dream about?
Space. Elbow room, pastoral things. Place in the country.
And I dreamed that the Lendrix virus reached this country and wiped out half the population. And now I have a place in the country.
Here you are. Excuse me. Here for you, sir. Enjoy your meal.
I'm afraid I can't find any of this plausible.
We know each other, Heather. I think we keep knowing each other through all of these shifts.
Then why don't I remember anything?
Because my dreams, they change things for everyone. It's like the past never existed. You can't remember, but you can feel it. Haber's having me made into an obligatory. I think he suspects it.
You can't do that. Not without a court hearing.
He's a powerful man. He can fix things. When I woke up after that last session and you weren't there, I was so scared that I had dreamed you away again. I have to go away where Dr. Haber can't find me. See that I'm not the stranger you think I am.
Where would you go?
I have a place in the country. At least I have a photograph of one. Please come with me, Heather. We'll get to know each other. It'll be like in the good old days.
I get that feeling. You know, like I've already been there. You know, deja vu, I get that a lot. Sometimes I wake up and, I don't know, it just doesn't feel real. I feel like I can't breathe.
Yeah, that's exactly how I feel. Like you've been squeezed.
I don't think I've ever heard you laugh before. It's very familiar to me.
I think this is it.
Don't dream us out of existence tonight.
I won't.
Promise?
Professor Haber.
Yes, what is it?
There's no sign of Mr. Orr at his apartment. They've been waiting there since they got the news.
I don't want him waiting. I want him looking, search the apartment, question his neighbors, the staff. Just find him.
Yes, Professor. George, if you must dream, and you must, maybe now's a good time for you to sleep, you know? Now, when you're...
I'm in love.
Is that what you are?
Like it was a dimension. Yeah, in love. Love all around. Like air, water, light, time. That's nice.
Say that you can remember your mother's heartbeat in your back.
Was that photograph taken?
I don't know. It looks nice, though.
You look beautiful.
afraid we might have to cut back on your dosage.
You find 3 times a day excessive.
I think that when your condition stabilizes, I think once a week will suffice.
Well, I mean, we have to cut back gradually. You don't want me to go into withdrawal shock.
I think you should have enough to hold you over for at least 12 hours.
What if I wake up with a sudden craving?
Then go back to sleep.
I can't just wake you.
Mm-mm. I'll be here.
Where are you going?
George, we can't just sit here. Haber's already got guys out looking for you. And I have to prepare your appeal as soon as possible.
How long is that going to take?
I'll be back tomorrow night. Think you can last that long?
No. But, if you have to go, would you mind stopping by my place and picking me up a change of clothes? My doorman will let you in. Manfred. Manny. You can trust him.
And this Manfred, he's, you still letting strange women carry off your belongings, is he? Mm-hmm.
You're the only strange woman I know, Heather Lash. And the only one I'll ever know.
Let's not be getting too far out of ourselves, George.
No. Let's get all the way out of ourselves. Let it be always now for us.
Always now. It's impossible.
I don't think so. I think it's what love is. Always now. Always now.
Are you sure, Professor, that you're doing the right thing?
The only thing I can. It's not gotten us this far, Penny. When I go under, just put on Orr's recording. And then don't speak to me. Just don't even stay in the room. Leave. Do you understand?
But I'm afraid that...
No. Listen, just do as I say. No more, no less. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
George Orr live here?
He does, but Mr. Orr is not home.
Oh, no. I know. I'm looking for Manny.
Ask and he will answer.
That's his bedroom right there.
Have you known George long?
Oh, it seems like quite a while. And the closet straight ahead. I was janitor at his school. Watchman on his first job. When he was in prison, I was a guard. When he was a patient, I was an orderly. But since then, it's mainly been elevator man or apartment manager. Nice man to watch over, George is.
Yes, he is. George.
Amen to that.
Manny, you're just gonna stay here?
That's my job.
You were frightened?
I was in the beginning, but I've gotten used to it.
Across the country, the president has made a special appeal for calm. He will be broadcasting this message until further notice.
I have declared the country under martial law to control this outbreak of social anarchy. There is no cause for panic. I appeal to everyone to please stay in your home for the next 24 hours.
Mr. Orr, you'll be taking one of our obligatories today.
Fine.
Good. I'll introduce you. Follow me. He likes to be called Doctor.
Is he a doctor?
No, not as far as we know. His memory loss is total. It's a curious condition. It has all the symptoms of Alzheimer's, but with a different pathology. Called central pontine myelinolysis, if you're interested.
Never hurts to know how ignorant you are.
soon. Has he gone out before?
Only in groups, but we think it's time he went solo.
Is there anything I need to watch for?
Panic attacks. He has almost no short-term memory and lives entirely in the present moment. While he's there, he's fine, but if he starts to look like he's getting anxious, just point at something, you know, distract him.
Okay.
How are we today, Doctor?
Hot to trot.
He has a tendency to be flirtatious. Calls me Lady Godiva. This is George. George Orr.
Either or.
This looks nice. You wanna go in?
If it's allowed.
I don't see why not.
The waitress will be with you in a moment. Enjoy.
Are you ready to order?
Just some tea.
Well, we have at least 20.
We'll have one of them. Two of them.
Any particular blend?
I'll have the first on the list.
And for your friend here, would he like the same?
I'll cross that T when I come to it.
He'll have number two.
Okay.
She's nice.
So, how did it go?
It went well.
How was your walk, Doctor?
I don't remember.
It was good. We both had a good time.
Good. Well, you can go to your room. That way. I think that went very well, Mr. Orr. He liked you.
How could you tell?
I just know.
Doctor?
Mm-hmm.
Who is Lady Godiva?
She was this lady in olden times. She rode on a horse, naked. Something like a fairy story. You know, once upon a time.
In the good old days.
Something like that.
Are you still open?
Kitchen's closed, I'm afraid.
Just a tea?
The usual.
I'll cross that tea when I come to it.
Where's your friend?
He had to go home.
He's from the hospital, isn't he?
Yeah.
He didn't seem so bad. A little lost, maybe, but...
He can't remember anything that happens after a moment or two.
And then? Well, I guess it's always now for him, then.
I suppose it is for all of us. If we can stay in it.
That's the trick, so they say. In the back with your tea.
Excuse me? This is gonna sound a little...
What, you gonna say that you know me from somewhere?
Would that be totally out of place?
Not if it were true. Heather Lalash.
George Orr.
Good night, Heather.
Good night, Manny. I'll be back with your tea.
Friend of yours?
Never can tell me.
Well, amen to that.
Where is it you think you know me from?
was trying to remember. It's not so much a memory as a feeling or a dream.
The mind, that ocean where each kind does straight its own resemblance find. Yet it creates, transcending these, far other worlds.